5 creepy unsolved mysteries that have totally been solved. When it comes to a mystery, there's a spectrum of possible reactions. On one end is the type of person who is happy to let it be and wander off to do whatever it is such people do. On the other end is the type of person who immediately starts howling to the uncaring wind that they'll solve the enigma if they have to sell their grandmother's kidneys to do so. Me, I'm firmly in the latter camp, and since you're reading this, I'm guessing you're the same. We, friend, are the fools who idly click some goofy link and 4 hours later find ourselves 42 browser tabs into the mystery. There may even be a notepad. Once again, I've done my best to dig out the most likely truth behind some of my favorite mystery tales. Let's speculate. 1. The Flannan Isles Lighthouse. In December 1900, a boat called Hesperus set sail for the island of Eileen Moor, one of the Seven Islets, also known as the Seven Hunters, of the Flannan Isles off the coast of northwestern Scotland. Captain James Harvey was tasked with delivering the relief lighthouse keeper as part of a regular rotation. The journey was delayed a few days by bad weather, and when Harvey and his crew finally arrived, it was clear that something was awry. None of the normal preparations at the landing dock had been made, the flagstaff was bare, and none of the keepers came to greet the Hesperus. The keepers, as it turned out, weren't on the island at all. All three of them had vanished. Eileen Moor had its peculiarities. The island's only permanent residents were sheep, and herders referred to it as the other country, believing it to be a place touched by something paranormal. Eileen Moor had long elicited a sort of fearful relevance in its visitors. The main draw to the remote location was a chapel built in the 7th century by St. Flannan. Even those who never prayed were moved to worship while on Eileen Moor. Superstitions and rituals, like circling the church's ruins on your knees, were adopted by those passing through, and many considered Eileen Moor to have an indefinable aura that could not be ignored. What the Hesperus crew did find at the lighthouse was a set of perplexing clues. The replacement keeper, Joseph Moor, was the first to investigate, and reported an all-encompassing sense of dread as he ascended the cliff toward the newly constructed lighthouse. Inside, the kitchen table contained plates of meat, potatoes, and pickles. The clock was stopped, and there was an overturned chair nearby. The lamp was ready for lighting, and two of the three oilskin coats belonging to Thomas Marshall, James Duckett, and Donald MacArthur were gone. The gate and door were firmly shut. These clues only led to more questions. Why would one of the keepers have gone out without his coat, and for that matter, why would all three have left together at all when the rules forbade it? Someone needed to man the post at all times, so something unusual must have drawn them out. When Moore returned with his report, Harvey had the island searched. The hunt came up empty. The captain then sent a telegram to the mainland, "A dreadful accident has happened at Flannan's. The three keepers, Duckett, Marshall and the occasional have disappeared from the island. On our arrival there this afternoon no sign of life was to be seen on the island. Fired a rocket but, as no response was made, managed to land Moore, who went up to the station but found no keepers there. The clocks were stopped and other signs indicated that the accident must have happened about a week ago. Poor fellows, they must been blown over the cliffs or drowned trying to secure a crane or something like that. Night coming on, we could not wait to make something as to their fate. I have left Moore, MacDonald, buoy master and two seamen on the island to keep the light burning until you make other arrangements. Will not return to Oban until I hear from you. I have repeated this wire to Muirhead in case you are not at home. I will remain at the telegraph office tonight until it closes, if you wish to wire me." Further investigations also led nowhere, though the lighthouse logbook provided a new set of confounding details. On December 12, an entry from Marshall described severe winds the likes of which I have never seen before in 20 years. He wrote that Duckett had been quiet and MacArthur had been crying, which would have been odd behavior for a man with a reputation as a tough and experienced seafarer. The next day, Marshall reported more storm details and wrote that all three of them had been praying, another odd bit of behavior from well-seasoned keepers in a brand new, supposedly safe lighthouse. Strangest of all, there were no reported storms in the area on December 12, 13, or 14, all should have been calm up until December 17. The last report in the book, from December 15, read, "Storm ended, sea calm. God is over all." Speculation ran wild. Was it something supernatural? Sea creatures? A case of madness and murder? A government operation? Foreign spies? Aliens? Ultimately, it was evidence outside the lighthouse that provided the most promising lead in explaining what had become of the three keepers. Over at the western landing platform, damage from the recent storms reached as high as 200 feet above sea level. Ropes that were usually affixed to a crate on a supply crane were littered about. Robert Muirhead, superintendent of the Commissioners of Northern Lights, wrote in his official report, "I am of the opinion that the most likely explanation of this disappearance of the men is that they had all gone down on the afternoon of Saturday, 15 December to the proximity of the west landing, to secure the box with the mooring ropes, etc. and that an unexpectedly large roller had come up on the island, and a large body of water going up higher than where they were and coming down upon them had swept them away with resistless force." While this, or a similar approximation, seems possible, the explanation left considerable room for doubt. The lack of bodies, supposedly calm conditions, and sheer experience and know-how of the lighthouse keepers still hadn't been accounted for, and never would be. In the years following, other keepers claimed to hear voices in the salty air screaming out the names of Thomas Marshall, James Duckett, and Donald MacArthur. In Mysterious Celtic Mythology and American Folklore, author Bob Curran writes, "For many local people, there was little doubt that they had been spirited into the other world." The likely solution, shitty weather. The very first investigation of the incident Occam's razored the shit out of the mystery. There was a storm, the trio was out securing their lighthouse keeping gear, and a large wave or a freak gust of wind swept them out into the raging sea. But what about the uneaten meal and all the signs that clearly point in the direction of, insert crazy theory here, you ask? And it would be a good question, if it wasn't for the fact that none of those mysterious clues ever existed. The original reports and documents of the case specifically mentioned that all the kitchen utensils were clean and there was nothing amiss in the lighthouse apart from two things: a single overturned chair by the kitchen table and the aforementioned set of oilskins. Luckily for us, but unfortunately for the ARG, it was Kelpies. Folk, one theory can explain even those. The island was littered with deep and narrow gullies called geos, which could catch water from particularly massive waves and hose it back with extreme force, catching people who were readying themselves for whatever came from the ocean right in the back and expelling them out into the sea. According to this version, the most experienced lighthouse keeper was attending to his duties in the lighthouse while the two junior ones were securing shit out on the landing stage, which, it turns out, was located right in one of the geos. When he noticed giant waves approaching, he ran out to warn his comrades, leaving his rainwear behind and knocking a chair in his haste. Two guesses as to whether he ventured too close to the waves in his panic. 2. The gas mask creature of Switzerland. Every day for the past decade, an unknown person has been patrolling the forests of Switzerland. Without fail, this person walks an identical route through the forests and mountain trails has evolved into something of local folklore, usually spoken in whispers and stifled giggling. All this changed when a reported photo of this individual was published. Multiple theories for this odd behavior. All of the reports that have been made down the years say roughly the same thing: in addition to a military-style uniform, whoever this is has a long cloak or a trench coat that has witnesses, and the populace torn whether this is a man or a woman. To add to the confusion, a vintage gas mask conceals this individual's face. The general assumption that this is a man in some form. From this conclusion, different people have different ideas. Some believe that they have seen a spirit or ghost. Others reckon that this is a living hermit or bushman who has done nothing more than reject modern life and other creature comforts. More extreme ideas can be counted among the more recent. someone might have hedged their bets and come to the conclusion that the world is going to end soon, and is making preparations to that end. Perhaps this is a woman who has a mental illness and is looking for her soulmate. In the middle of a Swiss forest wilderness. If not her, then perhaps a man with a terrible skin condition who grew tired of ridicule and withdrew from civilization only to be glimpsed occasionally. He, or she, is a sinister-looking individual that, probably unintentionally, tends to frighten anyone that comes forward as an eyewitness. Despite this reputation, there is no apparent threat or malevolent behavior towards witnesses at all. One reported sighting even went as far as making the point that flowers were in the hands of this person. Swiss police have long sought a dialogue with whoever this is, not because a crime has been committed, or indeed is a likely outcome, but simply to inform them that their appearance is, at best, unsettling. Encounters. When the photograph was taken by the witness's mobile phone and went viral, interest in this person hit an all-time high. Compared to sightings of the Loch Ness Monster in Scotland, this person quickly earned him, herself a suitable nickname, Lillian. This witness provided an account of the encounter, that hindsight has determined it to be benign and passive, but at the time the witness was so disturbed by what he saw, that he chose to remain anonymous. They found themselves almost within touching distance of each other and exchanged glances, before Lillian turned and walked away from the witness and his family. The witness took the snapshot after settling his family down. He took the photo with added care and caution, just in case. Another witness that was happy to be identified was local resident Marianne Desclooks. Her encounter with this strange person took place in 2013. Desclooks didn't go into a lot of detail, but did admit that the sighting was unpleasant and not something she was keen on repeating. Her description was strongly similar to many of the others, but on the day of her sighting it was raining persistently. Even though Lillian has not displayed any harmful intent whenever spotted, there are some people who are not prepared to take the chance that this will never happen. Many families will no longer venture into the woods in order to reduce the risk of meeting this person, and even fewer women will visit the forest alone for the same reasons. As the end of 2013 approached, French website Le Matin published a suicide note that was discovered in a forest alongside Lillian's trademark outfit. The note said that increased scrutiny had made suicide a much more preferential decision. In closing, the note mentioned 19th century Austrian author Sacher Masoch. Masoch entered into a relationship with Baroness Fanny Pister that was unusual for the time. He signed a contract that compelled him to do whatever she wanted him to do. Pister was also required to wear a fur coat whenever she felt in a cruel mood. It was this relationship that gave the world the term masochism. Is this a clue to Lillian's true identity? A lot of people don't believe that this suicide note is a literal one, but just a case that Lillian began to feel uncomfortable with the heightened awareness of their existence and took steps to put an end to it. No corpse was recovered at the scene. It is inevitable that the more adventurous will actively search for this mysterious person and make efforts to solve the enigma once and for all, but is that really such a good idea? Lillian, a firm product of the internet and has never shown any hint of animosity towards anyone. Surely it would be best to respect their wish and just leave him or her or it alone. The likely solution: just a few months after the story started making rounds, Lillian's clothing was found by the road it had been stalking, complete with an extremely passive-aggressive suicide note. It's in French, but here's a reasonably accurate translation. The note expressed Lillian's concerns that the recent exposure would lead to further attention, which forced the person under the clothes to abandon the walks, which the letter referred to as happiness therapy. Then, it snarks at the reader for not understanding the works of one Sacher Masoch. Yep. We're talking about Leopold von Sacher Masoch, as in the granddaddy of masochism. So, yeah, while in theory it's still possible that Switzerland just barely dodged a Friday the 13th situation here, it sure looks a lot like internet attention just managed to freak out a harmless S&M enthusiast who merely wanted to mind their own business and suffer nature in peace. 3. The Elton and Antenna. In 1964, while trolling the depths to photograph the ocean floor, the crew of the oceanographic research ship USNS Eltonen made a startling discovery in the waters near Antarctica. Amid the countless prints of vast terrain 13,500 feet beneath the waves, one picture contained something that no one could imagine, what appeared to be a large antenna, anchored to the seabed. News of the object spread quickly, as did theories of its origins. Some thought it fell off a ship or was placed there by the Soviets, while others insisted that it was extraterrestrial, but the answer turned out to be much closer to home. According to the Fortean Times, this photo of the object, which came to be known as the Eltonen antenna, first appeared in the New Zealand Herald in 1964, calling it a puzzle in the ocean floor. Early speculation ran wild as to who could have produced such a complex seeming piece of equipment, and was able to lodge it in the sand over 3 miles below the surface of the ocean. One writer described it an incredible piece of machinery, very similar to a mix of a TV antenna and one telemetry antenna, leading some to believe it likely fell off a boat. Others contended that it would be impossible for such equipment to descend to the depths undamaged, and become so well positioned in the ocean's choppy waters. A biologist aboard the Eltonen named Dr. Thomas Hopkins, perhaps one of the first to see the photograph, speculated that the long object, with several protruding spokes, was in fact some form of plant life. This, of course, was quickly dismissed due to the fact that no light can reach so far beneath the surface. Still, Hopkins couldn't deny the man-made appearance of the mysterious antenna. "I would not say that the thing is made by man, because this claim raises the issue of how it would get there," said Hopkins. "But it's very symmetrical and the spokes are 90 degrees apart." As the strange discovery continued to puzzle the scientific community, retired airline pilot and UFO enthusiast Bruce Cathy proposed a theory that the antenna was actually some alien artifact. "The shape of the object and the angle of its spokes," he said, "fit precisely into a formula he believed extraterrestrials used to control humanity. The nodal points of the two grids, when joined by series of small and great circles, formed what I have loosely termed polar squares around the north and south geographic poles. It was when I carried out a geometric and mathematical analysis of these sections that I found a direct connection with light, gravity and mass equivalence in a harmonic sense." As the Red Scare ended and pages of dubious pseudo-scientific theories yellowed over time, some might have thought that the origins of the Eltonen antenna would remain a mystery through the ages, until researcher Tom DeMaurier famous set the record straight. It turns out that the object, which seemed like some piece of advanced technology or alien broadcasting device, was actually discovered in 1888 by Alexander Agassiz, and was not an antenna at all. Rather, it was a species of deepwater sponge, called Cladorhiza concrescens. Later, the sponge's strange appearance drew a similar comparison from scientists Bruce Heason and Charles Hollister, who, studying Agassiz's drawings of the creature, said it somewhat resembles a space-age microwave antenna. As the news of the true origins of the Eltonen antenna spread, and nature was given due credit for the creature's odd design, some in the pseudo-scientific community expressed disappointment that their alien artifact had been debunked. It all goes to show that while the human imagination can invent new worlds full of strange, fascinating creatures, there's no shortage of such things on this world as well. The likely solution: just kidding. That shit was totally solved years ago. It's a fucking deep water sponge called Cladorhiza concrescens, people. The whole antenna debacle was started by a 1964 New Zealand Herald article that nonchalantly referred to the photo as something like a complex radio aerial jutting out of the mud bottom. Although that very same sentence clearly stated this phrasing was only because the reporter was a layman, sometimes a figure of speech like that is all it takes to get the insanity ball rolling. Still, I'm not going to present this as a 100% accurate solution to this dilemma, as the fact that few people of scientific authority have ever deemed the antenna thing worth debunking further complicates things. You'll notice the links I use, though seemingly accurate, have names like waterufo.net, and even the better articles out there gleefully quote Wikipedia. 4. The Orang Medan. Like the Mary Celeste, the SS Aurangmedan is one of the most famous ghost ships out there. You've probably heard the story even if you don't recognize the name. In 1948, or 1947, depending on the source, the Aurangmedan, a Dutch freighter traveling near the coast of Indonesia, sent out a series of increasingly panicked distress calls, containing the message, "All officers including captain dead, lying in charge room and on bridge, probably whole crew dead." After that, the Morse messages exploded into a barrage of SOS calls, finally melting into incoherence before returning with a final, clear, chilling line, "I die." The chilling message was, in fact, a very clear and desperate attempt for help, saying that all the crew including the captain of the ships were dead, and were lying on the bridge and in the charge room. Soon after the distressing message, a Morse code was sent from the ship. The message was almost entirely indecipherable except the grisly message, "I die." The message was clearly the indication that either a sudden calamity had befallen on the crew that left all but one crew member dead on board, or it was a massive hoax of some kind. Another possibility could be pirates, who could have taken over control of the ship and were now luring more small vessels in the vicinity. No one could be sure. However, a rescue vessel arrived at the location only a few hours later and tried to hail the crew on the Aurangmedan, but there was no response to the waving and shouting of the rescue vessel. A boarding party then was dispatched to check on the crew, but once on board, they witnessed some of the most horrible sights that have made the Aurangmedan one of the strangest ghost ships of all times. The crew of the Silver Star ship who had located the Dutch freighter, after a couple of hours of search, decided to board the vessel, which apparently seemed undamaged, ruling out the possibility of a shipwreck. The aim was to rescue the crew that were apparently reported to be dead or possibly injured for some reason. What they found instead was a deck littered with the corpses with frozen faces looking at the sun with wide open mouths and eyes staring open. The bodies resembled some waxworks of a surreal artist. After the initial shock, the crew went on to look for the survivors, specifically the man, who had reportedly sent a message for help, but every living soul on board was dead, including the only pet dog on the vessel. During their search for survivors on the ship in the boiler room, the rescue party felt a sudden drop in the temperature nearing 110 degrees Fahrenheit. The crew decided to tow the ship to the safety of a nearby coast to examine the peculiarity, but the ship quickly broke loose after a massive explosion. Here is another wacko ghost ship story from us 18th century ghost ship. The captain's body was supposedly at the table in his cabin, pen in hand. The ship burnt for a few minutes and later sank, taking the mystery of the death of the crew with it to the bottom of the ocean, possibly never to be found again. The likely solution: it's all pretty funny, because there's actually very little proof that the ship existed at all. The more you dig into the enigma that is Aurangmedan, the more it looks like it's either a completely fabricated story, or an amalgamation of several real but far less poltergeisty incidents at sea. Skeptics who have researched the case extensively have noted that the 1946 Lloyd's Register, a mandatory registry for all ships, makes no mention of the Aurangmedan or the rescuing ship, the Silver Star. So unless they were both brand new during the supposed incident, that's kind of strange. In fact, there is precious little available information of anything non-tabloid foddery about the ship, which seems more than a little strange considering that the similar but much, much tamer case of the Mary Celeste is routinely featured in respectable publications even today. In fact, the only available mention about the ship is from an article in a Dutch newspaper that specifically states that the story is almost certainly fiction, which didn't stop them from running it three times that year alone. From what I can tell, that's what set the ball rolling, and an urban legend was born. Hilariously, there's a clearly stoned out of its face 1959 CIA document that repeats the story near verbatim before breaking into a rant about inexplicable balls of fire and old English chronicles about Hollow Earth UFOs. Some may find this damning, but all it convinces me of is that the agency had the best drugs back in the day. 5. The Odyssey Notes. On April 24, the University of Chicago Library announced a contest to decipher mysterious margin annotations in a rare edition, of Homer's Odyssey printed in Venice by Aldus Manutius in 1504. This was only the second edition of the Odyssey in Greek ever printed. The first was published in Florence in 1488, and this particular example passed through many hands, several of which left marginalia in various languages on the pages. The two-volume book is part of the Bibliotheca Homerica Lainana, BHL, a collection of rare early print editions of Homer's works that was donated to the library in 2007 by Michael C. Lang. Lang had noticed that in the second volume of the 1504 edition, there were handwritten annotations that had some French words mixed in with what looked like a shorthand. Researchers at the library weren't able to crack the idiosyncratic script, so they opened it up to public at large with a $1,000 reward offered by Lang, for the first person to identify and translate the code. People from all over the world responded to the challenge. Less than 2 weeks later, we have a winner. The feat was accomplished Danielle Matilli, a computer engineer, archival science student and general lover of ciphers, with the help of French speaker and stenographer Giulio Chatta. He's in Italy and couldn't make a trip to Chicago to view the book in person, so the library sent him high-resolution images of two pages from Book 11 of the Odyssey that have the annotations in question. Because the shorthand was mixed with French, and because one of the notes contains a legible date of April 25, 1854, Matilli and Ochetta started by investigating French shorthand systems that may have been in use in the mid-19th century. The earliest French shorthand methods were created in the 17th century, one by Jacques Cosrid in 1651, the next by Charles Alois Ramsay in 1665. Neither of those systems matched the one in the Odyssey. They then turned to 19th century systems, but none of those worked either. It was an appendix in a 1792 book on stenography by Theodore Pierre Burton that pointed them in the right direction. The appendix included a table that compared a stenographic system invented by Samuel Taylor in 1786, to a tachygraphy, from the Greek word for swift, system for the French language invented by Jean Calin de Thevenot in 1776. The notes in the Homer edition looked very similar to the tachygraphy in the table. Matilli and Ochetta located a copy of Thevenot's Manuel Tachygraphie de Francais, an 1819 edition of Tachygraphie ou Tachygraphie Française by stenography professor N. Petit, and two mid-19th century French translations of the Odyssey and got to work. In Thevenot's system, every consonant and vowel has a starting shape, and they combine together to form new shapes representing syllables, Matilli wrote. The vertical alignment is especially important, as the position of a letter above or below the line, or even the length of a letter segment can change the value of the grapheme. This explains why most notes in the Odyssey shorthand are underlined, the line being key to the transcription. They were able to translate almost of all of page A and some of page B. The mysterious marginalia are French translations of Greek words and phrases, questions about the text, definition comparisons, corrected errors, the kind of notes someone who is studying Greek would take. Most people wouldn't scribble their notes in the margin of a very rare, very expensive 1504 edition, however. Why not get a cheap mass-market contemporary edition if you're going to write all over it? Also, most people in 1854 weren't using shorthand that was popular 50 years earlier. Cracking the code has yet to solve the mystery of who this eccentric annotator was. In his report, PDF, on the deciphering of the marginalia, Matilli proposes three possible hypotheses: 1, the notes were written by a student; 2, by a teacher; 3, by a translator. If 1 were correct, you'd expect there to be more unnoticed errors in the notes. The other two possibilities would explain the competence of the translation, and 3 would be quite likely to be familiar with shorthand systems. Matilli then had a bit of a coup de foudre. The main edition of the Odyssey we used as a reference was translated by Edouard Sommer, and published by Hachette book by book starting in 1848. While transcribing the shorthand, we had noticed how the annotations sometimes seemed to use the exact same wording as the argument analytique found in that edition. The summer translation is very accurate and close to the text, just like our annotations. The other translations of the time, Berest, Le Conte de Lisle, look nothing like it. So it finally came to me, which year did Hachette publish Book 11 of the Odyssey? Which year did the annotator write his notes? The same year, 1854. What if Mr. Summer were our mysterious annotator? Sounds downright plausible. It still doesn't explain why in the world he used the Manutius edition, of course, but that's some quality Nancy Drewing right there. $1,000 very well deserved. I know from the wonderful responses to the World War I shorthand post that we have several shorthand pros in the house. Be sure to check out Matilly's report because there are all kinds of details about the system and translated passages in there. You don't have to read French to enjoy it. The likely solution, ha, no. What do you think this is, the 1990s? The Chicago researchers glanced upon the internet, and realized that it's full of people like you and me who enjoy putting together pieces of old, weird puzzles just to see where it takes them. So instead of doing the whole driven experts slaving away at decoding the impossible thing usually associated with cryptography, and mystery solving in general, they decided to make a field day out of the situation and set up a contest. They put the mystery script online with a "no one can figure this out" disclaimer, adding a $1,000 prize for the person who could figure it out and translate select portions of the notes. If you've ever taken part in an ARG, you know precisely how that shit went for them, in the time it takes you to scratch your head, go, huh, and pop out to buy beer in an effort to drink yourself into the mindset of a cunning trickster demon. Some clever bastard already figured out the next 17 steps. Precisely this happened with the Odyssey notes. The bet you can't do it nature of the contest created huge global interest and tons of submissions for solutions, and a handful of people totally managed to figure out the answer to the riddle. The winner was Italian computer engineer Daniel Matilly, who recognized the script as a borderline impossible, obscure, shape-shifting, underline-heavy shorthand invented by Jean Calendar Thevenot in the 18th century. And the secret that was revealed after the code was broken is dot. A slapdash French translation of the book. Huh. Well, no one said every mystery is an exciting one.